everyone. Welcome back to Cupid. Just got home last night after spending the weekend over doing stuff at the house and hanging out with the grandparents. So, hey, now I'm back to do this awesomeness, this messed up, dark awesomeness. And I hope you guys are enjoying it, you know? And if anyone has come onto my YouTube channel and wants a suggestion, Cupid. Cupid is an awesome story. I mean, it's like freaking just so cool, and like the people who wrote the story are just so awesome. So if you want to start anywhere, I suggest you start with Cupid or Who Is Mike. They're by the same people, so one shorter though. Who Is Mike is way shorter. So let's go ahead and jump back in. I left you guys on a cliffhanger. I bet you're happy about that, right? Yeah, she's in the room with Guillemy, and he was sleeping. Rosa blew the candle out. She scuttled behind the small table. It barely hit her. Guillemy had changed position in his sleep. Now his face was in full view and facing her direction. Rosa's heart banged in her chest. It was so loud, she was concerned the room might echo the sound and announce her intrusion. Rosa waited for a few minutes before moving. She decided to crouch down, holding the unlit candle close to her chest. Easy now. She shuffled away from the bed in relief. The candle was dead, but her eyes were now well adjusted to the darkness. Sorry, guys. She could make out a desk in the furthest part of the room. He must do most of his writing there. There's a huge chance the journal is near. It wasn't very dignifying, but Rosa decided to crawl towards it. Now that Guillemy's face was in full view, a flutter of the eyelid was all it would take to catch her. It would be better to minimize her risks. Yep, yeah, you can crawl along the big part of the bed and over to the desk and steal things that you shouldn't be stealing. It's a good idea, Rosa. She dropped to her knees and placed her palms on the floor. That sounded gross. She drew her hand back. Was she imagining it? When her palms touched the floor, it felt warm. Ugh. Grody. Wet. Her fingers were sucked into the floor as if she touched soft, pulpy flesh. The hallucination was so strong that her nose detected a spray of iron in the air. Her stomach heaved. She rubbed her hand. There was no wetness or blood anywhere. The floor was solid. It must have been her imagination. Rosa touched the floor warily, patting it and pulling on the carpet fibers. Just a normal carpet. Rosa let out a slow, small breath as she started to move once more. She padded her way to the desk. Every time her skin came into contact with the floor, bile rose up to her throat. It took some effort to resist the urge to gag. Finally, the desk was directly in front of her. She looked back at the bed. From this angle, it was hard to tell if Guillemy had moved. She hoped that the big desk also hid her in the shadows. Rosa rummaged. There was no trace of the book on the table. She only found a pot of ink, loose sheets of paper, and a quill. That damn thing had to be close. She opened the first shelf and found a stack of papers. Nothing. She shuffled through them, but the drawer didn't have the journal. She looked through the second drawer. And the third. There was nothing of interest. Finally, she pulled on the last drawer. It was locked. Rosa sucked the air through her teeth. Of course it's locked. How could I have been so stupid? Rosa slumped in a depressed heap. The key. Rosa looked at the key in her hand. She slid it into the hole and heard the lock click. A deep feeling of relief washed over her. The drawer slid open. Rosa looked inside. There it was. In her eyes, the green journal was a treasure. She lifted the book from its resting place. It was heavier than she expected. Well, she's probably been writing in it for a long time, so she's probably been, like, adding pages and stuff. Rosa smiled. She ran her hands along the velvet cover of the book, savoring the texture. At last, she had it. Child. Mother's voice was riddled with anxiety. Something is wrong. Her excitement had clouded her senses. Almost at once, she felt the change in the air. Everything was still. Her stomach shrunk into its cavity. Fresh sweat broke out on her scalp. This silence. It had weight. It pressed on her skin and made the air thin in her lungs. Rosa stood up. She had to leave. Now. Rosa shuffled her way out of the room. With every step, her legs seemed to stick uncomfortably to the floor. It slowed her movement. One more step. Her whole foot felt like sinking. She held onto a chair and staggered back. It was throbbing, musty and red, alive and without skin. The air was filled with the unmistakable stench of fresh meat.
Okay, so either he has dead bodies under the floor,
Or he's super into making, like, homemade jerky and sausage. Like, she's gonna open a closet and just see all this, like, meat hanging in there. He's like, what? I like making my own food. Calm down, Rosa. Rosa ran to the door. She didn't care that the handle seemed to curl around her fingers. She pushed the door open and spilled into the corridor. Rosa fell to her knees while she heard the door close behind her. It almost felt like the door closed by itself. In her confusion, she couldn't be sure. Rosa's heart pounded heavily in her ribs. Just looking at the doorway of the room made her skin crawl. Rosa gathered her wits and stared at the journal in her hand. She hoped it would contain the information they needed. Ooh, chapter 6. Look at that, guys. Good intentions. In the warm, dim light of the library, Rosa opened the journal's cover. She wasn't too surprised to find that a number of entries were written in different tongues. The dates jumped from decade to decade. The writing spanned centuries. Another suspicion validated. Guillemi was not human. Or at least, he did not have a normal human lifespan. This discovery made Rosa search her mind for her date of birth. It distressed her that she could not remember. She shook her head and turned back to the journal. Despite the multitude of languages, the first entry was translated in several languages. For sentimental reasons, perhaps? Or maybe a feeble attempt at reminiscing a more innocent time. I am learning to write. Aelia gave me paper. I like Aelia. She wants me to call her mother. She smells like oranges. She says I am a gift from the goddess. But I don't know any goddesses. Aelia calls me Rai. I guess that is my name now. It is nice to have a name. The other preceding pages were still in a different language. Rosa flipped through the pages until she came upon one she could read. They call me Eros, a god, a divine. They don't understand what I am. They either build me statues or spit at my feet. I am a muse, I am a blight, a symbol, but I am not the answer. It seems ironic, isn't it, that love craves love above all? That which I need, that which I am, poisons me to the point that I am sick of its taste. I see it in the way people look at me, the way they act around me. Some would, of course, think of me as blessed. I have youth, health, and the gift of being loved, but I found out that these gifts are curses as well. My youth forces me to always wonder. My looks guarantee that I will always stand out. And love? The very same urge that blesses me quickly turns rabid. Yet I understand why. Oh, love, we all crave it, don't we? In the end, we are all drunk on the idea that only love could heal our brokenness. They all think I am this cure, but I keep hoping there might be something else besides this twisted sentiment. There must be, mustn't there? Rosa read the words and found them tugging at her heart. This was the same feeling she had had for years. It almost seemed like the words were her own. I know I am not supposed to be writing this. God, forgive me. I do not want to write it down. If I do, it will be the truth. Oh, Lord, please forgive me. I didn't mean to do it. I just wanted to stop hurting. I'm hiding now. I slash my face and cut my hair so they would not recognize me. Pain. Pain is good. A penance. Oh, Lord, please. If there is a God listening, please strike me down. Bad memories began to surface in Rose's mind. Desperation. A cornered animal that fought back. It reminded her of her own sins. Her hands were drenched and red. And yet, here she was, planning to kill another man. This had been her goal all along, hadn't it? That same familiar guilt began to stir in her mind. She bit her lip. Rosa skipped some entries. Most of them were garbled, almost incomprehensible. They were written in old ink, faded and unloved. Still, though, they were melancholic. They painted a picture of a man with sufficient black humor to keep sane. The plague has confirmed my suspicions that I do not die from sickness. I don't know how to feel about that. Everyone is dead. But on the bright side, everyone is dead. For decades, I have searched for something in this life, and I am always disappointed by transience. What am I looking for? Meaning? Hope? Love? Death, maybe? I can bleed. Wounds to the heart heal slower than the rest of my body. I think I may die if wounded enough. I have tried that. There was a time when seeing myself bleed was the only reminder that I am not numb. Yet my body does not form scars, no matter how many times I draw my knife. Like any sign of age or ugliness, they all fade. A wrinkle today, gone the next, as if my body isn't even my own to brand. That is a shame. I want to mar my body so badly that anyone who sees me will flee. But I have tried that too. People are crueler when you are ugly. Why is that? Why do they feel the need to punish you simply because you are detestable? Perhaps because they can? Or perhaps because it is easy to be cruel to those which do not belong? I don't belong. It would be nice to disappear one day. There it is. There is confirmation that he can be killed. So he bleeds like everyone else, but heals enough to die, or not to die. A strike to the heart. If we find a way to leave this wound open, perhaps he can be exterminated. Rosa continued reading. Another feeling was starting to grow in her chest. She began to question her cause the more she read through the journal. I have been staying in the old March farm. They are good people. They invited me to eat with them, and it was in the warmth of their fire that I knew then that I must leave. I will only destroy their happiness. For the briefest of moments, I was able to experience what it is like to be part of a family. Not an outsider, but accepted. Little Sissy has taken a liking to me, though. Children are curious creatures. They are a constant reminder to humans of their own impending death, their own weaknesses and mortality, yet people keep making them. One may wonder why, but it is not difficult to understand. It is the tantalizing thought, the hope, that no matter your past mistakes, you were able to make something pure at one point. Watch it grow, watch it live. Such a poor thing, looking up to you for love and care. It is both power and vulnerability, both selfish and selfless, a curious thing indeed. Rosa shuffled through more pages and saw a different penmanship in one such entry. It caught her eye. New century, I like it. I smell change in the air. It is so much easier to lie when you have the means. Trading is a good sport. My name nowadays is Baron Eric Delbershire. How could I have forgotten mankind's paralyzing obsession with titles? Names have power. Titles have power. I simply bought a horse and good robes and introduced myself as such. Everyone fawned over it. I could get used to this. This taste is refreshing. I must plan this better next time. A background, a story. People love stories. Maybe I shall be an actor next? Cretans everywhere. Human nature stays the same. The powerful will take advantage of the damned. So it is all a struggle for control? Is that all there is? I have thought it would be different somehow. In a learned class, in a different era, what was I expecting? Fortunately, I am already well acquainted. The next entry's penmanship was scratchy and difficult to understand. I am tired of this life. It is all an endless cycle, and I can't stand the taste of this any longer. Love turns to ash in my mouth. I am trying to stop. I want to stop. It is my seventh day without consuming anything other than normal food. It barely grazes the bottom of my stomach. I want to see if I will die without eating love. I am sick of this. Now you know what he is, Rosa. He consumes love. I do not know exactly what he is, but he is a monster, a demon. Didn't I tell you? I felt it in my bones. Let's read more. Perhaps there might be more. This is my 10th day without it, and I am still alive, barely. I can't even see where I am, where I'm writing anymore. I am so weak, my body is in pain. Am I dying? I'm afraid. After all my whining, I still want life. Isn't that funny? I am sleeping again. Sleep is the only thing that sustains me. It is dangerous for me to linger in sleep's domain, especially when I have not eaten. I have to keep writing. It's the only way to tell my mind is still my own. Maybe I should find something. I can't take it anymore. So that was why he fell so easily for the sedatives. That is not all. Perhaps we can destroy him this way as well. He is most vulnerable right now. If we attack now, he won't be able to put up any defenses. I have rewritten all of my entries into a new journal. I have kept some that were close to my heart. I don't know why I still keep writing. Perhaps this journal is my will to live. I look back on it, and it reminds me of the years I have endured. Sometimes I have a suspicion that this is my only reason, this perverse obsessive compulsion to hoard time, years, names. It can't end because it's such a shame. It is almost time to leave again. My ship arrived in France today. I plan to settle in a small town. I am sick of the taste of instant gratification. Maybe I will try a different approach next time. I need to blend in with the citizens first. My French needs work. Why do I keep doing this to myself? I shouldn't care so much. It always ends up broken or destroyed. I never learn. I should leave before. The entry was not finished, and some fresh pages were torn out of the book. Even if there were no names mentioned, Rosa felt that the last entry was for Catherine. There were more entries that she didn't explore, but she decided to close the book. She had read enough for now. Rose's hands were shaking by then. A growing feeling of understanding came over her. His thoughts were too much like her own. They were too similar. Guillaume consumes love. Rose remembered the taste in her mouth when she had kissed Catherine. There was something else in that kiss, a boundless flavor that coated her mouth and made her realize how hungry she was. The same night that Catherine began to change. Rosa's throat throbbed. The thumping felt like it resonated through her whole body. Rosa fell to her knees. That same feeling of dread began to rise up in her throat. The mere mention of the thought seemed to summon the feeling in her chest. She gagged. Did I taste Catherine's love that night? Then that means that I am also... Mother? Am I the same? She hastily pulled out the locket that Guillaume had given her previously. It was still as difficult to open as before, but right now Rosa was armed with a terrifying conclusion. She struggled with the damn thing until she thought her nails would peel off her fingers. The pendant popped open, revealing a yellowing portrait inside. Oh, finally figured it out, have you? Do you see it now? Do you see why Mother wants his punishment? My child, he is a monster. The very thing I stopped you from becoming. Don't you see? I saved you. I stopped you from feeding on other people's love. I didn't want you to be filthy. Mother's love is all you need. You haven't learned enough. Now you know what to do. Kill him. He is what I have feared the most, Rosa. He must perish. Rosa's face contorted into worry. The discovery of Guillaume's identity shook her to her core, but it also made her feel the burden of their years together, perhaps the understanding of his pain as well. Must we really do this, Mother? You still have doubts after everything you have learned? No, but this knowledge just makes me want to... You stupid child. Can't you see it is what should be done? Do it for me. You must do it for me. For my peace. Is it really? Is it easy to say that? But what do you really want? Are you really this daft child? He devours the minds of those that love him. I cannot think of a more disgusting creature. We must destroy him. It needs to be done. He needs to pay for the victims of his curse. But is it really the right thing? Is death the only way to change him? Maybe not. But must we risk it? He has become haughty and powerful. Soon enough, this power will drive him mad. Am I not like him, Mother? I am also a monster. We are the same. You are not a monster. I have raised you, guided you, and loved you enough. All my sacrifices were for you, to stop you from turning into something like him. Oh, I was always afraid. Always, always. But you are my dear daughter. He must be a monster, or he may be a monster, but you are not. Because of me. Because of a mother's love for her child. Now that you know his true face, there's only one thing to do. Kill him. No. No? I think he can change. Perhaps I might still be able to save him. He will not listen to you. What makes you think he will listen to you? He has fed for centuries. His addiction is his own curse. It controls him. Yes, but isn't he a creature of love? So am I. Love, no matter how lonely and depraved, always gives all of itself. Only I can understand. Only I can save him. This is what I want to try. What do you intend to do? The spell cannot be reversed now. It is dangerous to leave it unfinished. I will light Agape and make him remember. What if it doesn't work, child? Agape is a blessing, not a curse. A monster of his caliber will only shrug it off. And what would become of you then? Please don't do this. Trust in me, Mother. All right, guys. I'm going to save it here on another cliffhanger. I know. I'm sorry. Well, I'm not sorry, but I'm sorry, guys. I hope that you guys are enjoying this. So what do you guys think? Guillaume is an incubus, and Rosa is his daughter. Isn't that freaking crazy? That twist. And she is also, she's a succubus. That is what she is. Pretty much. And reading his journal entries, you can see how much he has suffered because of his, what he deems a curse. Every time he falls in love with someone, every time he gets close to someone, this curse of his literally sucks them dry, you know, until they go crazy or they finally die or something, you know, like Catherine finally lost her mind and committed suicide. And she even tried to kill him, you know. So he tries his best to avoid people because he knows that if he doesn't, then they will die. It's like he tries to avoid the people that he starts to love, whether they be friends or they be people like Catherine, who he fell in love with. And it's very upsetting. It's very sad to know that he is pretty much just, like, given up on himself. You know, like, he's like, well, I might as well just give in and suck these strangers dry. And then he meets Catherine and he doesn't want to hurt her, but because he doesn't feed regularly, he winds up literally causing her to kill herself. So yeah, that is the awesome, amazing twist of this game, is that Gammy is an incubus and Rosa is his daughter through her mother, who was also driven crazy. So yeah, that is why her mom was so nuts. It was because of Gammy. So yeah, now you guys know. Isn't that freaking nuts? Isn't that awesome freaking nuts? I love this game so much. But just to preface, after this ending, I do want to go back and get others. And there are some that are going to make you cringe. And I mean hard cringe. You're going to be like, oh, what? Why would they even go there? But it's only going to make you cringe because I got this ending before I got the others. So you, if I had gotten the others first, you probably would have been shocked if once I'd gotten this one, but you would have been like, oh, you know, but yeah, now you're going to be like, oh God, why? I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry to make you cringe so hard. But thank you guys for coming in for another episode of Cupid. You guys have been super awesome. I think I'm going to go over, I'm going to try and see if I can get Styx to download again. If not, then I'll just maybe play some more Sunless Sea for you guys, or just pick another one of the games that I have sitting around. But thank you again for coming in and watching this, you know, for coming back every day for another episode of whatever game I happen to be playing. I mean, you guys are just so awesome to come in and support me and give me your feedback and stuff. So I love you guys, and I will see you guys in a little bit with a totally different game. Maybe Sunless Sea, maybe a surprise, who knows? You guys will just have to wait and see, all right? Love you guys. Bye.